Good morning, church. Good morning. Welcome to Austin Christian. We are incredibly happy and glad that you are here with us worshiping. If you're visiting, we're glad that you're here as well. And we hope that you enjoy your time with us in worship. This is a great time, great opportunity to worship our God. Please bow your heads and let's pray. Almighty God, we are so humble to be here this morning and to worship a great God, a faithful God, an incredible creator. Father, we pray for our service this morning. We pray that you will bless every aspect of this service. God, we pray that you will please be with Dave as he shares the message. We pray for our hearts to be ready, to be engaged, to receive your word, Father. God, we're thankful for the incredible things that you've done in our lives. Father, I know the world, there's a lot going on in the world, lots of challenges, families going through a lot of things, but Father, we know that you're working, we know that you're healing, we know that you are rescuing us. And for that, we praise you, we honor you, and we worship you this morning. It's in your son's name we pray, amen.
My Savior. The next song we're going to sing is King of My Heart, just an affirmation that Jesus is Lord, He is first, He is King, and we serve Him. Worship with us. Love, she just talks about how unexplainable it is, unjustifiable it is for God to love us the way that He does. You have been so, so kind.
Good morning. Great to be together. We are actually filming this on Saturday. Hopefully you guys are all nice and cozy, staying safe and warm from all the crazy weather. If you're new to Texas, welcome to the Wild, Wild West. We were on the parking lot last week enjoying the wonderful weather. This week, we're all hiding out from the ice and the snow, and next Sunday, if we're lucky, it looks like the forecast is for 70 degrees, we'll be back outside, so hey, welcome to the Texas winter, but hopefully you guys are doing well. Miss seeing everyone this morning, but I want to continue on with our worship and our series that we've been doing on resilience and being resilient, and this week, I wanted, the title of the sermon is Train Your Brain. And you say, okay, what is that supposed to mean? Well, let me ask you a question to kind of get started, kind of an introductory thing. You can even discuss it with your family there as you're watching. But here's my question to you. Are you an optimist or are you a pessimist? Okay, simple question. No judgment. This is no judgment zone, right? Are you an optimist or are you a pessimist? There's an old Jewish joke where it says, basically, what's the difference between a pessimist and an optimist? The pessimist says, I can't possibly get any worse than this. And the optimist says, of course it can. So, you know, maybe that applies for today. Anyways, what is an optimist? Optimists are generally confident that things will work out well, that good things will happen, that they will succeed with enough hard work. When bad things happen, optimists tend to contain their appraisals of threat and create positive appraisals about themselves, and they focus on their strengths. So does that describe you? You know, that's an optimist, right? A pessimist, pessimists generally believe that bad things will happen. They doubt they will have the skills and stamina to achieve goals. When bad things happen, pessimists tend to exaggerate their appraisal of threats and blame or criticize themselves. And they underestimate their own capacities and overgeneralize the nature and the extent of the problem that they are dealing with. I heard another story about a guy who had twin boys. One boy was a pessimist and one boy was an optimist. And so he decided to give both the boys some gifts. And so and so he put them in the room. And so in one boy, in the pessimist boy's room, he put all kinds of games and video games and all the stuff this kid would have wanted, right? And in the other boy's room, in the optimist's room, he put a bunch of manure. And so about an hour later, he goes by the rooms, and sure enough, the pessimist is in his room, and he's kind of down and sad about it. He's like, son, what's wrong? He's like, well, you know, I got all these new toys and all these new games, and the batteries are going to run dead eventually. My friends are going to, they're going to be jealous of me, and they're probably going to break. Then he goes to the next room, and there's this optimist son in this room full of manure, and he's happy as a clam, dancing around, and he's like, son, you know, what's going on? You're so happy. And he's like, well, yeah, because all this manure, there must be a pony in here somewhere. And so, you know, that's the difference, right? And again, this is not a right or wrong thing. Most of us are oriented one way or the other. We're oriented either towards an optimistic view of life, or we are oriented perhaps to more of a pessimistic view. I'm not here to say you're right or wrong. Sometimes that's just kind of how we're a little bit hardwired. But it is important when it comes to the subject of resilience, because studies on resilience show that optimism is a key component. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that all resilient people are optimists, but rather that all resilient people at least find a reason for optimism. So maybe you might be by nature a pessimist, but we have to become situational optimists or realistic optimists, right? So you think about it that way. And so I use the word optimism because that's kind of sort of a way that, you know, perhaps in science and these studies, how they use the word. We could also look at it perhaps from a Christian standpoint of saying, well, what about being faithful, right? Optimistic. It sometimes sounds kind of pie in the sky. We're not talking about being pie in the sky. In fact, as they've done studies on optimism, they would say this, that somebody who's a situational optimist, if you will, or a realistic optimist, they do pay close attention to negative information that is relevant to the problems that they face, but they do not remain focused on the negative. They tend to disengage rapidly from problems that appear to be unsolvable, and they know when to cut their losses and turn their attention to solvable problems. So, and if you think about it, that's a really important characteristic of being resilient. And I think we all have. You think about this in our culture today. If you kind of lean towards pessimism, we all, and even if you don't, we all tend to have an attentiveness to negative things around us. The saying goes in the media circles that, you know, bad news sells. And so oftentimes we are inundated with negative things. We're inundated with negative press, negative news stories, because that's what draws our attention. And because those who dispense news know that, they want your attention. So therefore, what are they going to play? A lot of negative things. And so we're kind of drawn to that. We're drawn to negativity somehow naturally, even whether we're a pessimist or an optimist. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8 says this, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. You know, there's a lot of wisdom in this verse, a lot of wisdom in as we think about the negativity and the importance of optimism and faith. You know, this verse talks to us about our brains and how we think. He says, look, think about these things. Focus your minds on the things that are good, that are noble, that are right, that are pure, that are lovely. You know, as we think about our brains, you know, a little bit of kind of brain science. I'm not a brain scientist, but read some of this stuff. So, you know, if you are a doctor of brain chemistry, you can correct me later if I'm wrong. But here's how the brain kind of works. There's the amygdala and the hippocampus, and they're both part of what's called the limbic system. Now, the amygdala, if you know anything about this, it's the reptile brain. That's the part of your brain that basically, you know, responds to fear and alarm. It's what lights up if you're walking out across the street and a car comes barreling towards you. Man, you know, you are thankful at that moment in time for your amygdala because it's going to light up, fire, and you're going to run out of the way. That's kind of what the amygdala does. Interestingly enough, it's also connected in the same system with the hippocampus, which was where your learning and your new memories happen and where you regulate stress. Interesting combination. And so what happens is when we have negative stimuli or with fears or things get alarm gets triggered in us, the brain stores that away and then we end up reacting in the future in the same way, even if the danger isn't the same. What do I mean by this? This happened to me. So when I was in college, my freshman year, I had never given blood before. And so one day, I was coming out of my dorm room, me and my buddy were going to work out at the gym. I'm 18, I'm dumb, okay? So my friend says, hey, and they were doing a blood drive in the lobby, and so I thought, well, that'd be a really good thing to do. I got a few extra minutes here before we hit the gym. I'll go give blood. My friend goes, yeah, it's a good thing, man. Just squeeze the ball, and your blood comes out faster. You'll get done quicker when you get over to the gym. So I was like, sounds good to me. So I go over, I lay down on the bed, they do the whole thing, they hook you up. I was fascinated. They put the needle in, the whole deal, and I see this little bag there. That's kind of cool, and they give me the ball. And so I squeeze the ball, and I'm like, huh. And I mean, that blood, that bag, if you've ever given blood, you know, the bag's kind of flat. It just kind of filled up, like, super fast. And so the nurse, who's kind of over watching over things, and she's just kind of strolling back and forth watching the five or six of us that are giving blood, and she turns around and looks at me and sees that bag already full. Like, she hadn't even gotten done walking past the other four or five people. Her eyes got big as saucers. She runs over to me, rips the thing out of my arm, and I'm like, sweet. I sit up, and right back down I went. And for the next, like, 30 minutes, I had, like, every nurse in the place, like, giving me cookies and apple juice and orange juice. And, you know, I mean, I'll be honest, as an 18-year-old, I kind of enjoyed that attention. But, you know, the reality is, I mean, it was a kind of a, I felt, it was a weird thing that happened. And so I felt sick from what I had done. Well, fast forward many years later, anytime I go into a doctor's office where I can even smell the things that associate with needles or giving blood or any of that stuff, I instantly get lightheaded. I can watch a surgery on TV, wouldn't bother me a bit. But you put me in that place where some of those same stimuli hit my brain, it automatically fires that instinct in me that goes, uh-oh, you're going to get sick. And that's how our brains work. There's not even a whole lot of sense to it because certainly I know intellectually that if I give blood, I'm not going to die. In fact, I'm not even going to get sick because I am not squeezing that ball again the same way I did the last time. But even knowing that, it still gets a reaction. I've gotten better over the years and I've kind of retrained my brain not to feel that way, but it's taken a while. Now, why is all that important? Because here's the thing. We all have negative things that have happened to us in our lives and in our past. And those things, what happens oftentimes is they get stored in our brains and they come back up when things happen. And so we have to understand that memories, here's the kind of cool thing about how it works in our brains. They do actually remain unstable or malleable for a very short amount of time before that event then gets sort of hardwired in. And so what happens is, for example, you guys, maybe you've seen the movie Top Gun. You remember when Maverick, has that accident and his friend dies, and they're like, you know, the captain's like, get him back in the plane, get him back up there now, because if he doesn't get back in the plane, he'll never fly again. It's that kind of concept. I read a story recently about a guy who was a skydiving, and he was going to straight line skydive, which means you're diving without a partner. And so it was him and his six buddies, and they were going to get up in the plane, they're going to fly. And they're going to jump first skydive. They get to the plane, and the plane is like, I mean, it's like a jalopy of an airplane, and it didn't start initially. They had to kind of drive out and jump start the airplane. Like, I mean, I'm thinking at that point, I'm getting off the plane. I mean, I'm not even superstitious kind of a guy, but I'm like, no. If the plane don't start, I'm not staying here. So they had to jump start the airplane, and they get up to altitude, or starting to get towards altitude, and the engine throws a rod. And the whole cabin fills with smoke, and everyone's freaking out and panicking. And remember, this is their first skydive adventure, right? Like, real one. And so, amazingly, the pilot keeps his wits about him. He's able to actually navigate the plane into a field and lands the plane relatively safely. Fire crew shows up, checks everybody checks out. They're okay. And so they give them a ride back to the airfield. Well, this guy basically walks into the skydiving place and says, hey, I want up on the next plane. And so they're like, are you crazy? You know, he's like, yes, put me up there. And so he goes in, and he's literally, as he tells the story, he's literally shaking as he's putting on his jumpsuit and gets all geared up. And I mean, it's just he's visibly shaken, but he gets on the plane, and he goes up, and he jumps. And he tells this story because really, all of our fear responses, it's a chemical response in our brains. And so he overcame that and said, look, I'm not, if I allow myself to sit in the negative experience that I had when I had this plane situation, I'll never, ever jump again. So I'm going to go do it now. And so I felt like, what a great example of this, right? So I share that to say that there's a lot of power in how we think. And I think we need to understand that our memories and our minds work in really crazy ways, but they are malleable, even in negative experiences. How we think about those experiences in the immediate moment is important. But even as we remember them, this is the crazy thing, is that the studies have shown that our memories, they get hardwired, but then what happens is every time we remember it, they're unstable and malleable again for a short window of time. So every time you remember a negative experience, you can actually reprogram your mind about it. Crazy stuff. But when you think about Philippians 4, why does Paul say? I mean, I don't think Paul was sitting there with a brain chemistry book reading that going, this is what, but the Spirit of God was moving through him as he penned those words and says, look, what you think about, how you think, what you focus on makes a huge difference. There's a lot of power in how we choose to think. And so I want to share with you this morning what I would say are four moves towards becoming a real, resilient optimist, okay? So it doesn't matter if you're a pessimist or optimist, that's fine. We're all different places than that, right? But to have the kind of resilience that we need to have, here are four things I'd like to share with us that are all kind of, hopefully, kind of interconnected. The first is, look at the right things. Look at the right things. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 says this. It says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. Now, as we talked about last week, humanity has a problem, and that problem is sin. It's a cosmic problem. We're all kind of wrapped up in it. Yes, it's a personal problem, obviously for us individually, but it is a collective problem that we all have to deal with. And the truth is, I mean, the science backs up the Bible, and talks about the fact that studies have shown that anxiety and stress and worry, it prematurely ages our brains, right? I mean, God doesn't want us to live this way. Sin messes us up, right? And so what we think about, what we focus on, is going to make a difference. And Paul does a couple things here as he writes this. First of all, he reminds us that of what's beyond us, right? He says, look, first of all, there's no condemnation in Christ. Now, that's great news. That is fantastic news. For us that are disciples of Jesus, followers of Jesus, there's no condemnation. I think we have to remind ourselves of that. Frequently remind ourselves of that. But I'm afraid that sometimes we walk around feeling like there is condemnation in Christ. He says there is no condemnation in Christ because Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death. But then he goes on, so therefore, because there's no condemnation, we are now free to set our minds on the things that God desires, the things that the Spirit desires. And I love that this passage talks about how God resolves the sin problem. He resolves this cosmic sin problem through what Jesus did. And so then now our objective becomes to focus our minds and our behaviors on the ways that the Spirit is leading us. And we can train our brains. We can train our brains to be godly because God has paid the price for us. Our objective is to keep up. The problem is, as you might guess, is that our minds have been accustomed to sin. So remember how we talk about our memories? We got all our memories. They're hardwired in there. Some of the things that we've done that are sinful, are things that are reinforced perhaps by the pleasure regions of our mind getting sort of triggered. And so all this stuff kind of gets stored and go, well, if I just do this, I'm going to feel good, even if I feel bad, right? And all this kind of weirdness that goes on when we think about sin. And so we find ourselves at times, as Paul might say in Romans 7, doing things perhaps that we don't really even want to do. Ever felt that way? And so we've got to begin with no condemnation. We've been set free. And from there, we set our minds on the things the Spirit desires. So when we think about that, my question for us this morning is, where are we setting our minds? Where are you setting your mind? On a daily basis, what do you fill your mind with? What do you fill it with? I mean, are we filling it with life-giving things, or are we filling it with life-stealing things? Lord knows there's enough negativity around us all the time that if you fill your mind with those things, you are going to create a very anxious life. Or do we focus on the things that God has given us, things that are life-giving? I might even say that if we spend more time watching the news than we do reading our Bibles, we might be in trouble, to be quite honest. Where do we focus our minds? So the first thing is this. The first move towards resilient optimism is looking at the right things, looking at the things of God. And then secondly is doing the right things. So there's looking, where's your focus, but then there's also where's your action, right? These things go hand in hand. The good news is you're not a victim. You're not a victim of your own experiences. You're not a victim of somebody else's bad behavior. You're not a victim of anything. You have choices to make. To do the right thing, to where to look and where to focus your attention. You're not a victim. The cool thing is that I was reading up on this, and so there's this thing in the brain called memory traces where with each positive thought, you can actually train your brain. And so the suggestion is to hang on, if you think something positive, hang on to it for 5 to 20 seconds. Like just literally thinking positively, thinking in a healthy way, focusing on the things that God has for us creates this positivity. Now, James 1:22 though says, look, you got to put your money where your mouth is, right? And verse 22, it says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. So don't just kind of look at the right stuff. Well, you know, I have my quiet time today, so there it is. Dave said I was going to be good. No. We've got to look, but we've also got to do it, right? He says, do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like somebody who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to in it, not forgetting what they've heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. In other words, we can't just look at the right things. We got to do the right things. We got to be doers of the word. I think it's a great question for us to ask. You know, am I a doer of the word? I think it's maybe a great question, a very, very, very simple, practical exercise we could ask ourselves every day. Is simply at, you know, whenever you, when you get up in the morning and you're, you know, you have your time of devotion in the word of God, you read, perhaps you pray, you have your quiet time, you know, question you might just ask yourself is, what have I discovered today that I am now going to do? As I have looked into the Word of God, as I have prayed and considered these things, what am I going to do today? And how am I going to live into that? It's very simple, simple question. But if we do that on a daily basis, it's amazing the changes that come. Number three, develop habits that encourage a godly perspective. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12 says, one verse we all know, I'm sure, pretty well, says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. I love this passage about the word of God because it speaks to the fact that the Bible is so relevant and it speaks into our lives. And in fact, it's almost like it kind of gets into our thoughts and our attitudes. Well, why? Because God created us. He knows how we're made. And so the words of the Bible have so much to say, even about our internal lives and about how we think and about how we act. And so we've got to develop habits that encourage a godly perspective. And the Bible helps us with that. I think it's important to remember that our fears and negative experiences, you know, how we feel, that's just the brain reacting, chemically reacting. The important thing is not what you feel about something, but what God has to say about it. And so you might have some kind of reaction you don't even understand sometimes to things that go on around us. But we've got to filter that through a lens of what God sees, His perspective. That's why the Word of God is so important in our lives. Think about this. You know, I want to encourage us to develop habits that, you know, godly habits that help us to maintain a godly perspective. Some of them are simple. You know, many, I would hope all of us, we have a habit of reading our Bible and praying. Those are great habits that help us maintain a godly perspective. Meditating on the Word of God, reading a passage and just sitting and contemplating, you know, what that passage really means in its depth and what it means for my life, and taking the time not just to have some intellectual assent to, hey, that sounds like a good thing, but really soaking on it, thinking about it, meditating on it, you know, writing it down, remembering it throughout the day. I mean, this kind of level of meditation on the Word of God, you know, a reading, just read as you read through, perhaps grabbing a section of Scripture, reading it multiple times, to where we soak in what that Scripture is saying to us. Praying through the Psalms. You're trying to get a godly perspective. I mean, I tell you what, I mean, the Psalms are primarily prayers, and they are songs. And you read through those, and, you know, I know I've been doing this for a while, and you know, I'll read through several Psalms a day just kind of as part of my prayer time. And it's amazing how just even doing that kind of infiltrates the way that you think and the way that you see the world. We want to have a godly perspective. Mentorship, you know, having people in our lives that are godly themselves and bouncing things off of them that we are thinking and feeling and seeing and in the intent of having a more balanced godly perspective. Most of us left to ourselves, who knows? Like I said, there's lots of tapes playing in the back of our minds. We need mentorship and we need help. So developing these habits, you know, having regular times with somebody else, that you know, another spiritual person that you're getting with and talking with and praying with and being open with and talking about what's going on in your mind. Guys, these are habits that help us have a godly perspective. The fourth thing is this, is reframe the negative experiences, your negative experiences, through a God lens. And Genesis chapter 45 is the best example of this. Joseph, we all know the story of Joseph. Joseph was sold. Okay, first of all, Joseph had a pretty terrible life for the most part, right? I mean, think about it. He was a favorite son, which was kind of cool, had a good childhood, but then he was sold by his brothers into slavery. You know, and even in that, he kind of got picked up by a guy who was actually a pretty good guy and gave Joseph a lot of responsibility, but then his wife comes on to Joseph and he gets thrown in prison for stuff he didn't do, and now he's in prison and even in prison the jailers kind of like him, he's a good guy, but then anyways, long story short, he gets stuck in there longer than he should, and you guys know the story. Eventually he kind of comes out of prison because of his ability to interpret dreams, and he rises to become second in command of all Egypt to Pharaoh. And it's about that time that his brothers come to Egypt seeking food in the middle of a famine. And as you all know, there's this whole story about how Joseph reveals himself and all this sort of thing happens. But in chapter 45 of Genesis, verse 4, I want you to listen in to how Joseph reframes what was really quite a negative family experience. I mean, I don't know that any of us have experienced this. Maybe you have. But in verse 4, he says, "Then Joseph said to his brothers, 'Come close to me.' When they had done so, he said, 'I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt.'" Okay, that's going to sting. Right? A little confrontation there, right? It's like, you know, guess what? Come here. I'm Joseph. You know, I'm pretty sure they were afraid at that point. "And now," but this is what he says, "and now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there has been a famine in the land, and for the next 5, there will be no plowing and reaping, but God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then, it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household, and ruler of all Egypt." Wow. I mean, I kind of get goosebumps reading that. Like, I'm so blown away by Joseph and how he reframed what was really negative. And now, not only that, I mean, now he has power to do something about it. I mean, Joseph could have gone nuclear on those guys. I mean, he could have made their lives. I mean, you talk about payback, he could have had as much payback and more. But he reframed the entire experience through a God lens. He says, "Look, God brought you here, brought me here. All that you did, I know you kind of probably meant bad by it, but look, it was all kind of orchestrated. God had a plan, and he was doing something with this." And I think about this, we've got to train our brains. If we're going to be resilient, we've got to train our brains to look at things, even negative experiences, through a God lens. It's amazing. He wasn't bitter. He wasn't bitter. I think he was conflicted. When you read the whole story, he was conflicted about what he's going to do. But you could almost kind of see him kind of working it through. Like, okay, I wasn't sure this day was ever going to come, but now it's here. And how do I think about this? Am I going to give it to him or am I not? I'm not quite sure Joseph had it figured out up until the moment. But he had to kind of work it through a God lens. And I think that's so true in our lives. As we experience perhaps at times negative things, we have to kind of go, okay, wait, what is God doing? And amazingly, he had no bitterness towards his brothers whatsoever. And so in conclusion, the challenge here in terms of being resilient today is to train our brains. How do we do that? Well, we got to look at the right things. where we focus our attention, what are we looking at on a daily basis? We need to do the right things. It's not just enough to kind of go, okay, well, yeah, great, I'm going to look at the Bible. I'm going to look at, you know, good things. But what are we doing to act on those things that we're seeing? Developing, and along with that, developing habits that encourage a godly perspective. Guys, let's get into the Word of God. You know, let's get into our lives in prayer. Let's make sure let's rededicate ourselves to surrounding ourselves with godly mentors, people that we respect that can help shape our thinking as we wrestle with these things. And finally, let's reframe our negative experiences through a God lens. In Hebrews chapter 5, I want to read this before we take communion. It says in verse 7, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. A son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. You know, we get a snapshot here in Hebrews of Jesus and his wrestling and how he processed. It says he did so by the very things we just talked about. He offered up prayers and petitions and with cries and tears. Jesus himself had to wrestle through the different things that were coming at him just in the same way that we do. But it says that he was heard because of his reverent submission. He submitted himself to God. He was able to capture that God lens, obviously. And it says that he learned obedience from what he suffered and was made perfect and became the source of salvation for all of us. You know, we celebrate that when we take communion. We celebrate that Jesus is the source of eternal salvation for us. He gave his life for us. But he came to that decision. He came to that through obviously a lot of suffering and wrestling with what the right thing to do is and wrestling with God's will and all these things. But he came through for every single one of us. And we celebrate that by taking the bread, taking the cup today. You know, let's reflect on these things as we pray now and take communion. God, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you for the many ways that you've blessed our lives through him. God, we want to train our brains, our thinking, God, to think the way, God, that you want us to think. God, we know that you've created us. We know that you know what's best for us. I pray, God, that you would help each one of us to really dive into your word, to be connected with you in prayer, God, to be connected to one another and those in our lives that are godly, that can help us and shape us. And God, I pray that we would be humble enough to allow that in our lives. In the same way that Jesus learned submission through obedience, God, I pray that we would do the same. And God, that we would act on the things that we know. And Lord, I pray that in so doing all these things, God, that our thinking and our minds would be set on you. But God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for his sacrifice. Thank you for his example. And God, we know that we are beneficiaries in so many ways of this, but most importantly, God, we're so grateful for the salvation that was bought and paid for through his blood. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
To woo us back from death.
you're choosing us. And we choose you.
My heart surrendered.
On Valentine's Day and every other day.
Looks like the weather's going to be fantastic next Sunday, so we are planning to be back outside together on the parking lot, believe it or not. Hope to have many of you as possible join us for some fellowship and worship next Sunday. Secondly, if you are a small group leader, please be mindful of the fact that we do have a small group leader check-in tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. You should have the link in your inbox, but just want to remind you guys while I got you here. All right, let's have one last song, and then we'll be done.
Darkness, we were away without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. To redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son. Praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. In the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath. Till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, peace.
Amen.